Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As promised, Jason Evert here with us this hour. And you, as always, when Jason is on, if you have chastity issues that you would like to talk about in your own life, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Or maybe you want to talk about teaching chastity to your kids, helping them to find the joy of living in the freedom of chastity. You're welcome to call as well. Anybody who's got chastity questions can call 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. I will warn you, however, if you call and you have an Australian accent, we're going to be very suspicious of you because Jason went down to Australia and all heck broke loose. I don't like to use harsh language, but all heck broke loose down there in New South Wales. I'm going to read you a little bit. This is from, seriously, you're going to think this is a parody, but this is from the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, the broadcaster of Australia. Three Catholic high schools in the New South Wales Central Coast have canceled planned visits from a conservative American, and it's in sneer quotes, chastity speaker. Following mounting pressure from students and parents, the Catholic Diocese of Broken Bay had organized for Speaker Jason Evert to deliver love and lust talks in person to students at St. Joseph's Catholic College. By the way, in Australia, a college is a high school. In East Gosford, MacAllop College, and a bunch more. However, the events received backlash from students and parents, including planned protests and a petition against the talk, which amassed almost 2,000 signatures. Jason Evert, thanks so much for being here with us. Are you okay?
Oh, yeah. No, it was quite an adventure. And then, you know, we were able to figure out who is behind a lot of this stuff because they announced the victory on their Twitter page, which is a self-proclaimed group of witches. And they were the ones saying, we are the ones who got this thing shut down. Congratulations, yay, witches. And some of them use that as kind of a, no, we're not actually into Wicca. We're just like political activists. And other people on it were like, no, we're full blown into Wicca. And we're, you know, coming against everything that you're doing down here. And so they they flooded the schools with calls to, you know, saying, hey, we're concerned about that this is going to be a danger to our students, that this misogynistic traveling chastity preacher is going to shame our girls. And so they were calling the schools. They ended up trying to get online and snatch all the tickets to the young adult event, so young adults couldn't come to that because the tickets are free. They tried to reserve all of them. They called the hotel I was speaking at and tried to pressure them to cancel that event.
Really?
And so it was bonkers, and the media jumped in on this and had all this like fake news stuff going on of Jason teaches this and that, like stuff I don't even teach. And I'm like, man, if I taught that stuff, I'd sign the petition as well. So it was just chaos down there. But God works through all good. And so he ended up got more schools to fill in the ones that canceled, and then one of them live streamed it out to 8 other schools at the same time. And so and then the crowning cherry on top was the end of the last talk. I was 1,000 young adults, and one of the protesters got through security and dumped a can of tomato soup on my head at the very end of the presentation. So
that seems like a mature way to handle disagreements. Good Lord. I mean, every time I think California is a bizarre and an immature place, Australia's like, hold my beer. And, you know, like, yeah, but come on, Australia, get your act together. Really? This is what we're stooping to?
But there's a lot of good people down there. One of them was like, he was like, good on you, mate. You're right over the target. In other words, like, there's a reason there's been this like kick the hornet's nest kind of anaphylactic reaction in these schools in this particular diocese in Broken Bay. They haven't been taught this stuff. No. Even alumni were like, this is ridiculous. They're bringing in a chastity speaker. I went to high school there and they didn't teach us. It was just social justice. We didn't have all this sexual morality garbage. So, you know, it's new to them. But the kids that did get to go to the talk, you know, one kid came up and gave me a big high five. And he's like, man, the media is bull. Because he realized everything he heard online. One girl even messaged us on Instagram, and she was like, hey, coming into your talk, I was really afraid and nervous of what you're going to say. But she said, I don't know what point it was in your talk. She said, I started to feel like disgusted, and I wanted to cry when I realized how much these lies were that they were telling us about who you were. Because none of it was true, and your talk really hit me. And the kids came up afterwards, were like, you know, selfies and pictures, and like, will you autograph my book? And like, they loved it because they're made for love and truth, and they're not getting it elsewhere, apparently.
This also from the Australian Broadcasting Corporation. And I guess these are supposed to be the mature people. Listeners contacted ABC Radio on Monday to voice their anger and concern about Evert being invited to the schools with no disclosure about his background or views. Yeah, you've really hidden them, by the way. You have cleverly hidden your background and views.
Yeah, 26 years of like nobody protesting after the talk. Yeah,
something that really concerns me about him presenting to students, particularly those who may be struggling with their sexuality or gender identity. I would be very concerned about his thoughts and his ideas that he has conveyed on those two things, local woman Leah said. Are you bashing children? Is that a part of your ministry? Is bashing children who are confused?
It's part of the mission statement of what we try to do.
Now,
here.
Don't even joke, because they'll play that.
No, I mean, you know, and again, if some of the things said about me in the media were true, and I was a parent and I saw that, I'd be upset too, and I'd be like, wait a minute, I don't want that guy. The problem comes when you just trust the mainstream media and be like, oh, that must be accurate. Yeah, let's you know, block and ban this guy instead of actually looking. Okay, does he make these claims? And you know, if he doesn't, like, well, my daughter's intelligent enough to listen to a perspective and be able to see, okay, fact from fiction. Is this guy some misogynistic creep that's trying to shame our daughters, you know, which is one of the narratives? And no, that's why the kids, I've been there 7 times now, and the last 6 trips we talked like 30,000 kids, and there has been no backlash from any of those talks, because it isn't about shame and blame and homophobia and, you know, trans bigotry and all that. No, it's about God's plan for human love and sexuality. So now, I wouldn't trust the media. I wouldn't trust a bunch of self-proclaimed witches on Twitter. Just watch the teenagers, and I think they can make up their own minds of what they heard.
However, I do need to confront you with this that's also in the Australian Broadcasting story. In a note to parents late last week, the acting principal of MacAllop College, Paul Lynch, acknowledged the content of Evert's talk could be challenging and highly sensitive and may raise concerns for some of our students. Please be advised that we will have staff and counselors available to provide support if required. Are you traumatizing the children so badly with the idea that God loves them and wants them to be in loving, chaste relationships that they are going to need school counselors?
I mean, the fact that the kids would be that shell-shocked from a message of chastity says more about the school, I think, than it does about me. Yeah. And, you know, that having been said, like, when I do speak at a high school, afterwards, I tell the school, I said, you know, I know today's, I'll talk to the principal, hey, you know, tell the kids an announcement. We know today's talk, Jason talked a lot about serious issues. If you do need anybody to talk, our campus ministry is here for you. Our guidance department is here for you. Because when we talk about human sexuality in general, some of these kids have been through a lot of stuff. And they can't necessarily go home and talk to dad about it, because dad could be the one doing it to them. And so we do try to get the schools involved so that the kids have somebody in their daily life they can process some of this trauma with, if they can't safely go home to their parents. So yeah, there are some deep wounds here, but the solution isn't to bury that stuff. The solution is to come alongside the parents, who are the primary sex educators, and give the kids a positive and hopeful message about chastity. And so, you know, thanks be to God, during one of the cancellation slots, we filled in a Zoom meeting with 27 principals in the diocese and the bishop, and we were able to talk to them about trying to move forward in a more clearly Catholic way in the schools.
If you'd like to talk with the most dangerous man in Australia, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. No, it's not Ned Kelly. It is Jason Evert. And you are welcome to call with your chastity questions, or if you want to just ask him about the most the exciting trip he just took to Australia, 888-318-7884. And I hope that people know I love Australia and I love Australians, and I'm teasing them a bit when I say they're worse than California, because I also love my state of California. But there are sometimes things do get a bit out of hand, and this got a bit out of hand when you're dumping tomato soup on Jason Evert's head and you're not his wife. Something is out of hand. 888-318-7884 is the number to call if you have questions. So before we go to a break, Jason, if you would, because there are people listening who don't know what we're talking about, could you just give us the 2-3-5 minute capsule? What is your message to teens in Australia or Africa or Asia or the United States or Latin America? What do you say when you talk to them about chastity?
Yeah, and I know when people hear the word chastity, a lot of people kind of cringe, and all of these thoughts come into their mind. Oh, this is some, you know, prudish Victorian repressive idea about sexuality and shifting blame onto women because you're telling them to be modest. So you're basically saying it's their fault if a guy mistreats them. Like, all of this intellectual baggage sometimes just comes with the word. And so a lot of people just want to avoid the word. But John Paul II said that the word chastity needs to be rehabilitated. You know, we don't need to just bury it in the medieval history. Like, we should love chastity. Like, it's a beautiful virtue, and it frees us to love, because if I can't say no to my sexual impulses, then saying yes to them really means nothing. But then it frees us to know if we're authentically being loved. I think a perfect example of that, girl came up to me at a public high school dating this controlling, possessive jerk. And I said, look, you deserve so much better than this guy. Just break up with him. And she said, I can't break up. I've given him my virginity, my reputation. I can't just let go of everything. And I said, look, tell him no more sex and watch what happens. She said, okay. And she took her necklace off and gave it to me. She said, he makes me wear this. He's so controlling. I said, okay, I'll throw it away for you. And she left. 5 minutes later, she came back, happy as can be. She's like, I dumped him. I said, well, that was quick. She said, yeah, I told him no more sex. He slammed his locker shut. He threw a book at me. He said, where's your necklace? She said, I gave it to the chastity guy. And so you see what happens is she just tested his love. Like, do you love me? Do you want me? Or do you want the pleasure you're getting from me? And so it's that virtue of chastity, like I said, that frees us to love, frees us to know if we're authentically being loved. And it doesn't matter what's happened in the past, because I tell the girls, like, look, your value doesn't come from your virginity. Your sexuality has value because of you. You're the gift. You still have yourself to give. Anybody can start over. So it's a hopeful message, but unfortunately, because there's so much negative baggage with that word, it conjures up a lot of misconcepted ideas of chastity, and that's really what people are opposed to rather than what the message actually is.
888-318-7884, the number 888-318-7884. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with more conversation about finding the freedom that is available in learning to have self-control, in learning to have respect for others, in learning to have respect for our own body, all things that it just seems to me should be, I don't know if I'm allowed to use the word should anymore, but they should be something that any parent would want their child to hear about, but apparently are very, very upsetting to some parents and to some Australian witches. We'll be right back after this with more Jason Evert on Catholic Answers Live.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at magnificat.com.
A special item on EWTNRC.com this month is the official rosary of the 10th National Eucharistic Congress. Designed by Ghirelli, the crucifix has a grapevine pattern, and the centerpiece is a highly detailed replica of the monstrance that will be used at the event. Draw closer to our Lord in the Eucharist with this beautiful keepsake. To order, go to EWTNRC.com and search for item number 1512E.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. The number here is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. If you have questions about chastity, about marriage, about maybe helping your children to learn these values, maybe helping to live them yourself, you're welcome to call. Jason's happy to talk with you about them, 888-318-7884. And, you know, Jason, I make light of it, but it's wrong for people to treat you the way that they treated you. But you seem to rejoice, like the apostles did, to have been found worthy to be abused for the word.
No, I mean, it does feel like a privilege, because, I mean, I've had stuff happen in the past, but not to that extent. But, I mean, in perspective, what Paul got stoned, I got tomatoed, so it's, like, not really up on par with that.
Don't give people ideas. I am really strongly in the camp of don't give people ideas. But
yeah, no, I mean, it could have been worse than tomato soup. It could have been, like, broccoli and cream or something like that. So, I mean, it wasn't too bad. But it was hard to watch. What hurt the most is knowing that there were – high school students who didn't get to hear the message because, you know, of these mischaracterizations and what the media was doing. You know, when I saw these posts from the witches, I got on Instagram and I did a little message and I'm like, hey, you know, this is what's going on with these so-called witches. But I said, you know what? I consecrated before I left this entire trip to Our Lady. And I said, when you do that, she'll take care of everything. So I said, these witches thinking they can kind of overturn, you know, Our Lady's plans is like thinking, you know, some house cats can overcome some Siberian tiger. You know, it's not really a fair match. Now, the media got that clip. And then they did a story of Jason is fighting back against the parents, where it shows me saying, yeah, these witches thinking they're just like a bunch of house cats against a Siberian tiger. So they made it look like I was calling the parents witches
and yourself,
and calling them house cats and calling myself a Siberian tiger. So they just snipped it out, dropped the context to make it look like I'm this monster. They even ran an article of me holding an axe. This is the guy coming into your school. It was Blessed Pier Giorgio's ice pick that I was holding during World Youth Day. And they made it look like I'm an axe murderer coming in for their daughter. So it's really interesting how they tried to spin the whole thing.
Do you know that there are some people that still believe the news? That part's shy. Like they like, come on, you're giving credit to Our Lady for being a tiger.
Yeah.
Which she is a great warrior. And mm-hmm. they just lie about it. I mean, lie by deception, but it's so ugly. But you did engage in the many holy people on your behalf when you found out that this was going to be a battle.
Oh, yeah. I'm like, okay, they want to pull out their big guns, so am I. So I called up the Sisters of Life, Sister Bethany Madonna, had some of my colleagues contact different convents. And Sister Bethany Madonna was like, oh, we're on this. She said, I will contact all of our you know, religious sisters, especially the suffering ones. I called up Monsignor John Essef, who's just this unbelievable, his spiritual director is Padre Pio. So he's like big hitter. So, you know, we're on the ground, but I called in the air support, you know, with the A-10s and the B-2 bombers and bring out the big guns. And so what ended up happening, it's almost like, you know, what the devil tried to do through the crucifixion turned completely against him, you know, of not knowing the good that would come from this. In the same respect, what ended up happening, because all these, you know, protesters were stirring this up in the media, a girl reached out to me and she told me she was from America and happened to be in Sydney at that time to visit her boyfriend. And she found out her boyfriend was cheating on her. And she was just devastated. She's like, I am so sick of these Christian guys that promise the world and then just wound you and expect you to do this and that with them. She said, I'm done. I'm tired. I've saved my virginity for 25 years. I give up. And so she gets on like some dating app and she says, I'm just going to find some guy to hook up with. And she picked a couple guys. Then she got on Instagram to do their background check. And while she's on Instagram to pick the guy she's just going to randomly lose her virginity to in Australia, what pops up in her Instagram feed was this message I said asking to pray for the talk. And she saw it. She's like, wait a minute. I saw that guy when I was a teenager at my high school in America. I remember his message. And so she messages me on Instagram and I'm like, hey, I have a talk tomorrow night open for college students, young adults for free. Why don't you come? She comes to the talk. Here's the presentation. Then we have Eucharistic adoration. She goes to confession and she said it absolutely saved me.
God,
she never would have gone if this protest hadn't started. One girl even came up to me at a high school we were never supposed to speak at because the other one got canceled and this one jumped in its place. And she said, Jason, you have no idea how perfect the timing is today that I just heard your talk. And I said, you know, I wasn't supposed to be here 24 hours ago. I'm only here today because those people canceled their talk. And she just felt like God came only for her, which he did.
Amen. He did. Wow. What beautiful testimony. By the way, if you don't believe us, look it up. Just type in Jason Evert on your news feed and you will get a whole bunch of articles. I would say this is a bigger story than a robot priest. That's how big this story is. It's a bigger story than a robot priest. Joseph is in North Carolina watching on YouTube. Joseph, you're very welcome here. Go ahead with your question for Jason Evert.
Hello, Mr. Evert. Can you hear me?
I can.
All right. I'll say it brief. I'll just warn you that I happen to see you were talking today. And if some rawness and bitterness comes through, I'm holding it back. But all it is, I'm someone who has, in my family history, seen divorce after divorce, been scandalized by that, scandalized by people not taking marriage seriously. And on a day like today, where not relationship related, but some people badly mistreated me, what would you say to someone in my position where they're thinking, You can't trust anyone. Marriage, not marriage, anything. You can't trust anyone but yourself. So why would I even trust someone in a relationship? I don't actually think that. It's just a thought in my head.
Yeah.
What would you say to someone thinking that? Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you, Joseph, for just being so honest and raw and vulnerable with everything that you've seen. And who on earth could blame you, honestly? I think when you suffer a trauma like that and a repeated trauma like that, it's almost like getting your arm broken five times in a span of 5 days. You know, the trauma, you want to shield it, which is healthy and which is natural, and you put it in the cast, and it needs to be in that cast for a while because it's in such a wounded state. But the cast isn't meant to be there forever, because if we put kind of that cast around our heart, what ends up happening is that cast becomes like a cell. You know, it becomes like a castle around you, and then it becomes a coffin in a sense that, you know, no one is going to hurt me, and I know how to protect myself. It's by giving my heart to nobody. But what ends up happening is you become unbreakable because you refuse to be loved. And because the thing you want the most, love, requires the thing you fear the most, which is vulnerability. And you just know, look, I've seen enough to just basically know there's no one I can ultimately trust. And I think at these types of moments of having to go through this, one thing that's helpful is sometimes to find a good Christian counselor that you can have a safe place to process that grief, someone to receive that, to validate the wounds that you've heard, but then also to let Christ into those wounds. I'd recommend to pray the Psalms. Like, one third of the Psalms are Psalms of desolation. And one beautiful way to pray them is to find some of these good Psalms of desolation, because they're great, because you can really let God have it in these Psalms. Like, you did this. Why have you abandoned me? You know, why have you made my friends my enemies? My only companion is darkness. And you can really let him have it. So pray one of those just right from your heart to God. Then pray it again just as the voice of Christ, because these were the Psalms he prayed in his passion. And then maybe pray it a third time kind of with him together. I remember reading of a woman lost her faith because of the Nazi Holocaust, and she had just seen way too much suffering, and she just gave up on God. And she met a priest, and he said to her, all I want you to do is read this one particular psalm. It's often called the cursing psalm. It's not included in the liturgy hours because it's a little too spicy, but all it is just cursing your enemies. And he said, I just want you to pray this psalm, you know, once a day for a week or whatever, and come back. And she did. And when she came back to him, she said, look, if your God lets you pray like that, then I can work with that. Because these prayers that come from the depths of our heart, where we're just crying out to God in righteous anger and confusion and desolation, that's authentic prayer. And so I would say, don't give up on yourself right now. You might need to be in a protective state of like, look, I feel so jaded about that sacrament, and not obviously dive into that right now. Now's not the time to commit to a relationship. Now's the time to heal. If you can get active in your parish, you know, maybe you can encounter some marriages that are messy but functional, that, hey, that they aren't perfect, but man, they've fought through these tough times and they can rely on each other. I mean, I've met some couples like, we've been married 80 years and we've never had one single fight. It's like, wow, that's some couples. You know, then there's other ones that have been through the fire and they turned out great. And then other ones got married and they thought it was going to be all rose and sunshine, and it turned out to be an absolute dumpster fire. To be fair, there's a mix of all of that. And I think you've just been exposed to some of the really rough cases that made you want to throw in the towel. So we can't blame you. God doesn't blame you. But take a time, like you read in the Gospel of Luke, where the apostles come back from their mission work and he said, come away by yourselves to a deserted place and rest for a while. He doesn't say go away. He's saying come away, meaning come with me to kind of a deserted place and find some rest. And I think right now, come away with him for a little bit, find some rest, and then maybe in that rest, he can restore your hope and love.
Joseph, thank you. I'd also like to send you a gift in addition to all that magnificent advice from Jason. We have a lovely book called Secrets from Heaven, The Parables and Sayings of Jesus. And it really is a lovely book. So if you'd like it, just hang on the line. Edgar will get to you in a quick second.
Hey, Si, can I throw one more suggestion as long as you mention that? There's a guy out there named Joey Pontarelli who has a ministry called Restored, website I think is restoredministry.org. He wrote a book called It's Not Your Fault. He came from a divorced family, and his whole ministry is kind of reaching out to people who've been through broken families, who are just on the verge of giving up hope, to show them that you don't have to repeat the mistakes and broken marriages that might be like a plague throughout your genealogical tree. Like, you can actually change the current and not give up. up hope. So his name is Joey Ponrelli. He's got some great talks out there. Restored Ministry is the stuff that he does. But it's specifically to help people that have seen a lot of broken marriages not give up hope. Because that's what the devil wants to do, just discourage. That's his spirit. I want to pour in the spirit of discouragement so you miss perhaps the vocation that God has planned for you.
Joseph, I'm so grateful for your call. And please hang on. We will send you a copy of that book. I've got a couple seconds, and then the music's going to play, and we're going to go to a break. And then we'll come back, and we'll get to Emily in Cincinnati and Mark in Las Vegas and anybody else who calls, 888-318-7884. But I would read this ad after the break, but I'll read it before, since that's how the timing has worked out. And if you're looking for great deals on great Catholic books and gifts for dads and grads, visit shop.catholic.com this weekend. Use the promo code USA25 because, you know, we're celebrating those who gave their lives in the service of the USA this weekend. And you save 25% on every purchase over $25. Use the promo code USA25 this weekend, all weekend, at shop.catholic.com.
When it comes to Catholic teachings about Mary, there's one question we hear more than any other. Where is that in the Bible? The answer? Everywhere. In Bible Mary, the Mother of Jesus and the Word of God, Father John Weiss opens Scripture to reveal a Mary who has been hiding in plain sight. Order your copy of Bible Mary today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ, September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast, visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Why We're Catholic is the one book you can hand to anyone to invite them into or back to the Catholic faith. With more than 400,000 copies sold, Trent Horn's book has had a number one ranking on Amazon.com for 5 years running. Now available in softcover, book cases, ebook, and on Audible. Find out what the excitement is all about. Order your copies of Why We're Catholic at shop.catholic.com or visit whywearecatholic.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It is strange to live in a world where things that once seem solid have moved on us. And among them was the idea that parents wanted their children to get married and have children and for their sexual relationship to be a relationship in marriage. And now somehow that is seen by many people as oppressive and wrong and dangerous. And our guest this hour, Jason Evert, just with a message of love and respect for oneself and one's body and others, other selves and other bodies, really an attempt to really cancel them down there in Australia, an attempt that I'm happy to say seems to have backfired because thousands and thousands of people that never would have even known the name Jason Evert or known what he does, and it is great work that he does, now know. And so we'll just leave all those things in the hands of the Holy Spirit, who seems quite capable of handling them. But it is sad to think that so many people really see Jason Evert, the guy that wants to teach your children that God loves them and that they can do it, that they can have self-control, that they can respect themselves and others, and that they can live joyful, happy lives by accepting the gifts that God gives, that he would be anyone's enemy. It seems odd and sad, but as I said, the Spirit's moving. Let's go to Emily in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Emily, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Jason Evert.
Thank you. I am actually calling just to tell Jason thank you for what he does. And he, my daughter, actually, she is a junior in high school, and she took a TOB class this year. And
Emily, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Yeah.
Sure. You'll be surprised to hear this, but there are people who don't know what TOB is. So you might you might want to just tell us what that
theology
means.
Theology of the body. Okay. Yes. Okay, so TOB, theology of the body, which we are so grateful that John Paul gave that to us. But it's kind of a difficult topic to talk to your teen about. And so she took this class in a homeschool high school co-op, and we were just so grateful for everything that Jason kind of contributed to this book. It was the Ascension Press book. But some of the videos that he was in it. And then he actually came to Indiana, which is 20 minutes from where we live in Cincinnati, and gave a talk. And she got to go to that. And she came back and was just like on top of the world. She loved everything Wonderful. He had to say. She was so moved by it. Her boyfriend, actually, Jason, went to his high school here in Cincinnati and talked to those guys too. And her boyfriend got so much out of it. They got out so much out of it together. And it's just everything that Jason does has been beautiful. And Emily, my daughter has been very grateful, and so have we.
Thank you for tilling the soil. I mean, I sometimes get a lot more credit than I should. You know, you've been tilling the field for a long time, and all I come and just pour a little bit of water in there and something sprouts out of the ground. And like, oh, it's the water. It's like, no, this is rich soil. Like, you've been doing the hard work at home. When I was over in Sydney, one of the moms wrote to the newspaper and she said, I sent my daughter to that school so that she would be a strong and independent woman, not so she could hear outdated notions about keeping yourself pure. And it's like, this is the mom saying, I don't want my Catholic high school teaching my daughter outdated notions about keeping herself pure. And you could imagine the defensiveness that girl would have about the talk if her parents and her school look at Chastity that way. But the fact that you know it's such a gift, you know, your daughter becomes so much more open in the way her heart receives it. So thank you for doing the hard work at home.
Emily, thank you very much for the call. Let's go to Mark in Las Vegas, Nevada, watching on YouTube. Mark, you are very welcome here. Go ahead with your question for Jason Evert.
Hi, Jason. So I'm a middle school teacher, and I just want to see your take on this one, because you know you interact with the youth quite often. So we were talking about marriage, and you know, of course, you know, the old slogan that Bishop Sheen said, that you know, it takes three to get married, and then I just said that, and you know, it takes, you know, you have to have God in the relationship. And then one of the students said that my parents don't believe in God, but they've been married for 18 years, and you know, all they have is each other. And you know, but piggybacking on that note, I have family also who didn't get sacramental marriage, and they, you know, they cohabitate maybe for 20 years now, and you know, they have kids. I don't even know if I should even talk to them about it or revisit that. You know, once I have had a talk with them, it didn't go well. But, you know, should I even talk to them about, you know, still get your, you know, your marriage, you know, blessed? But anyway, I just want to hear you.
Okay.
Talk first in the first part. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, in terms of talking to the young people, absolutely. You could even draw kind of a triangle on the board. At the bottom two corners of the triangle could be the man and the woman, and the top point is God. And you could point out the closer that either one of them gets to the top towards God, not only are they getting closer to God, they're actually getting closer to the other person. And the more they both strive together to get close to God, that's what they can achieve the greatest type of unity, because they're loving each other, not with just our frail, broken human love, but with the love of God. And so to the extent you want to love your future husband, future wife, get close to God, because that's love himself. And so you could maybe draw up that a little analogy, since you're working with middle school kids too. The last caller, Emily, just noted that her daughter was exposed to the Theology of the Body program from Ascension Press called You. Just a note, Ascension is coming out, I think like this week or next week, with their brand new middle school program. It's called Envision. So it's like for sixth, seventh, and eighth grade kids. teaching them the theology of the body in an age-appropriate way. And so I think it's so important we put this stuff in front of the kids. That way chastity isn't some bomb you drop on a kid when he's 15 years old in some high school sexual ethics or commandments class. No, they got to be getting this stuff in junior high. There's other groups like Tobet or Ruah Woods that do stuff for the younger ages all the way through. But this new one from Ascension is awesome. I mean, they spent years developing it, and it's just brand new out right now, 6th to 8th grade kids teaching the theology of the body so they can see the big picture. Because a lot of times they just see the small picture of their dysfunctional marriage back home or their parents who are in a lasting marriage, but God isn't a part of that. That way they can understand that, okay, take what your parents have, which is great without God, and now imagine how much greater it could be with God himself in that relationship. So it's not either or. It should be both and. So I'd say, yeah, absolutely. Keep talking to them about that stuff so that the way as they get older, they can avoid the trap of cohabitation and other things like that and embrace what God's plan is for relationships instead.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you very much. We sometimes now are able to get questions from YouTube. We're trying to do a better job of that. And Jason, I'd like to share this one with you. Jason Evert is our guest. If you'd like to call and ask your question, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. All right, this question from YouTube. How do you maintain chastity in marriage? I'm going to get married soon. And I, as a female, have recovered from a pornography addiction, and he's struggled as well, but we're both now recovered.
Yeah, well, praise God that you both were able to get away from those traps and find each other. In terms of chastity in marriage, a lot of people hear that phrase and it immediately trips them up and confuses them because they think that chastity means celibacy, which is the state of not being married, or they think it means abstinence, which is just not having sex. I remember a mom came up to me after one of my talks for parents on chastity with their teenagers. And the mom said, yeah, I was coming here today. And my husband said, where are you going tonight? And she said, oh, I'm going to the chastity talk. And he looked at her and he said, well, don't get any ideas while you're there. It's like, okay, haha. You know, he didn't understand this doesn't mean necessarily abstinence. And so what chastity looks like in the sacrament of marriage, it's like, well, what is chastity? Well, you're using the gift of sexuality according to God's plan for that, for your state of life. And so obviously for a person who's single, it would involve abstinence. For a married person, okay, what is God's plan for human sexuality? It's my wedding vows made flesh, so that when you're making love, you're speaking those vows. I give myself to you freely, totally. I'm faithful to you. It's ordered towards procreation. So it's a really renewal of the vow in the flesh. So a violation of chastity would be something going against those vows. And so obviously things like pornography in the sacrament of marriage, to stand at the altar and say, well, welcome children, then to go off on the honeymoon and then contracept. And then obviously that's a violation of the promise that you had made. Now, if you have a serious reason not to have kids, you could fall back on natural family planning for a serious reason. But that shouldn't be the default. Like I know a lot of Catholic couples are like, okay, we're going to get married soon. What kind of NFP should we use? It's like, well, wait a minute. The default position is openness towards life. And then if you have a good enough reason to have to use NFP for a while, then you can kind of use that as needed. But often planning your family responsibly, family planning actually means more children, welcoming them as the supreme gift of marriage. And so fidelity in terms of chastity in marriage isn't just what you're looking at on the internet. It's how you interact with your coworkers in terms of emotional purity and chastity as well, because sometimes we can have our defenses up over here. You know, okay, no physical infidelity. Okay, but where are your defenses over here when it comes to emotional faithfulness to your spouse as well? We've got to make sure that that's filled up as well. Ignatius of Loyola in his spiritual exercises compared the soul to a fortress that has a castle wall around it. And so the evil one kind of walks the perimeter of the fortress to assess where the walls are weakest. And where they're weak, that's where he tries to go in and maintain, you know, possession of the fortress. And so kind of take a good look. If you want to look more into chastity and marriage, there's a book by Christopher West called Good News About Sex and Marriage, where he talks about the theology of the body and what that looks like for married couples living that out. If you are struggling with any residual effects of the pornography, for you, I'd recommend there's a ministry called Magdala Ministries, and it's specifically for women who've been struggling with pornography and the scar tissue that accumulates from that. If your husband perhaps might be struggling We did a book called Forged, which is a 33-day game plan for guys just to develop new weapons to battle temptations. Because, you know, as I know from someone who used to struggle with pornography back when I was in high school, it's not like you just shut the door and like, oh, good, we're done with that. You know, the devil's going to come in 1,000 different ways. And so we've got to be able to keep our defenses up to keep the father of lies from getting into the relationships that we're trying to build in God's plan. So Magdala Ministries and Forged might be some helpful resources. And then Christopher West, good news about sex and marriage.
Thank you for that question from YouTube. More questions on the line for Jason Evert. There are, however, some lines open. If you'd like to ask a question or get in on the conversation in any way, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
The Catechism defines evangelization as the proclamation of Christ and his gospel by word and the testimony of life. But what does that look like in real life? It looks like St. Paul street evangelists out in the public square sharing the good news. We're a Catholic nonprofit that starts conversations by handing out free sacramentals. Then we employ our method of listen, befriend, proclaim, and invite. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
One time somebody said to me, why don't you air these people? And I said, no, because I don't think they're Catholic. He says, by what right do you have to say that? I said, I own the network.
Mother Angelica Live Classics, every morning, 2 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest for this hour is Jason Evert. We started the hour, if you're just joining us, by talking about a really kind of amazing story that just happened to Jason. He went down to Australia to talk with some students in high schools there about chastity, about the love of God and the respect of self and body and all that stuff. That it, I hate to say it, but it's really basic stuff. It's not like Jason invented this. This is kind of the stuff that parents have been either teaching their children or hoping that someone else would teach their children for most of the history of the human race. But somehow it is controversial now, and people protested Jason. They got him kicked out of some of the schools he was supposed to speak in. Other schools invited him to come. It's really quite an extraordinary story. If you just look up Jason Evert in your news feed, and you'll be able to find out that story. But
but just check which source is reporting does whether or not you're going to believe anything that's said. It's all on one side or the other.
Yeah. Well, it's like in the old Soviet Union, you know, they would say they would have these news stories. And I remember that the prisoners that were, you know, political prisoners would read the news, and the news would be like, the Americans don't really have this or can't really do that. You know, they claim to have, and they would know just by reading the stuff that the Soviet press said wasn't true. They'd go, well, that's clearly true. Yeah. that did have it. I think people are smart enough sometimes to read that way. I am a little confused about where I'm going. I guess I can go to the phones in a quick sec, but Jason, you'll have to give me a quick second, then I'll be able to get to the phones. The number is 888-318-7884. But the end of the story from Australia is that Jason ended up with tomato soup on his head from a protester. But that led to people praying for that protester, praying the Hail Mary for that protester, and adoring Jesus in the Eucharist. And so all things are opportunities, I guess, Jason, huh?
Yeah, the poor Australians came up after me, and they're like, oh, we are so sorry that happened to you. And I'm like, ma'am, look, I have 8 kids, and I've been having food thrown at me for 20 years straight. So, like, this is really not a new one. I said, I typically look like this after any given day by bedtime anyway.
this is dinner.
Big change for
this
me.
This is after dinner for Jason Evert. Yeah. All right, Terry, thank you for waiting while I got my phone situation straightened out. Go ahead with your question for Jason Evert.
Yes, sir. I was just wondering, after porn addiction, what would you say making love looks like between a married couple that doesn't include the things that you're used to seeing in pornography, such as
know.
That's okay. You don't have to give us a, I'm a little anxious not to get examples on the air, but Jason, unless I'm wrong and you think we need examples.
No. I see the direction. So I think I can sufficiently, you know, get where we need to go without them. One of the things I think that needs to happen is some guys will say to me like, look, you know, I stopped looking at porn. I'm good. I can start dating. You know, I haven't looked at it in a week. And it's like, well, wait a minute. That's like me kind of like thrusting a sword into you and then just like pulling it out and be like, oh, the sword's out. You're good. It's like, well, yeah, but like your intestines are on the floor. Like we've got to do some repair work here. And so I think step number one is like, okay, do we need a time of really healing? You know, how long ago was it? Like, was it like 10 years ago and we've gone to counseling, or like, hey, this was a struggle as of a couple months ago? Because, you know, I remember growing up with pornography, like it would take 5 minutes to look at the stuff and then it takes 15 years to forget what you saw. And so I think going to counseling is really helpful, praying some healing and deliverance prayers, perhaps, that God can enter into those wounds and heal that. But then also to have really good heart-to-heart conversations with your spouse about particular things you might not feel comfortable with, of like, I know you've seen that, you might want to do that, but I really don't feel comfortable with that. I feel that in particular degrades me. And this is a widespread phenomenon among young women today, high school, college, when they're actually surveyed about what guys are wanting to do with them physically, an unbelievable amount of them are reporting like atrocious and violent things that the guys want to do because they saw it on the internet and now they want to act it out. And so it's really important for a husband and wife to be able to talk and say, honey, I don't feel comfortable with those expectations. And the very fact that you might want to do those things is telling me that, you know, maybe we need a little bit more time of healing in this area. And so thank be to God, though, that these difficulties are coming up to the surface, in a sense, that it's kind of like oil rising up in water. God wants to purify this stuff. And it's going to be messy. It's going to be difficult. But I think if you're both invested in the marriage, in each other, and in God, then one by one, you can start to work through these things. And then when those flashbacks come to mind, like if you have a thought of something you saw that's impure, take a minute and pray for that person that was in that pornographic act. Because we just think, oh, don't think about it. It's like, no, we're thinking about it. It's in my mind, but now I need to respond to that memory, to that person with love. Because maybe 6 months ago, I responded to lust towards that person. Now I need to love that person in my memory. And I'm gonna pray a decade of the rosary for them. And I'm like, hey, Friday, we still got a couple hours left. I'm gonna offer up a fast, you know, tonight for that person. So that way we're responding to the beauty of the body with love, instead of with lust or just mere repression. So try to pray for those memories, try to pray for your spouse, go to counseling if needed, and talk through your spouse so it becomes real clear what you're comfortable with versus what is objectively degrading.
Thank you, Terry, very much. I hope that was helpful, and I'm sure that what you were going to say was just fine. I just out of an abundance of caution, thought we'd just let Jason go with what he had. Teresa is in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on the Covenant Radio Network. We're glad to have you here, Teresa. Go ahead with your question.
Mine is just kind of like a statement. People seem to think that chastity is only a female issue, but it is also a male issue, and I think it's much more a male issue because they're the ones who are able to convince the women to give up their chastity. I have a son who we told that he could not go out until he was 16, and then he had a double date until he was 18. Well, his friends informed him that, well, he should tell us that he's homosexual. That way they will throw women at him. And I was like, what's wrong with this picture?
A lot. I think it sounds like the plot to a bad movie, frankly. But what do you make of this point that Teresa makes, that chastity isn't just for women?
Yeah, this was a very common point made in the Australian media this week, because two of the schools that I was scheduled to speak at were all girls' schools. The rest were co-ed, and in previous visits, I've done a lot of all boys' schools, but people are like, oh, look at him, just coming to the girls. So typical of the misogynistic, patriarchal culture that women are the one who needs to get preached to, and they're the ones we're going to blame for a lack of male self-control. And so to try to counteract that, I just threw up a little video on Instagram where I explained why women historically tend to be very defensive when it comes to the subject of modesty. And it's for two really good reasons. One is because when was the last time you heard a message of modesty directed towards men? Like, never. It's because we made the mistake of reducing modesty to clothing. And if modesty is nothing but clothing, the guys will be like, well, I have pants on, like, I'm modest today. But like, well, maybe the immodesty of the guy's intentions are far more immodest than any outfit she could have put on. Yeah. Second reason that women resent it is because literally for thousands of years, the whole problem of lust has been blamed on the body of the woman. She's the seductress. She's the occasion of sin. You know, you're wearing that outfit. You're kind of asking for it. That type of attitude has been going on for millennia. But what I encourage people to think of is like, look, what's the cause of robbery? Is it the presence of jewelry in the window of the store or the presence of greed in the heart of the robber? You know, jewelry doesn't cause robbery. And in the same respect, the ultimate cause of lust is not the body. It's the human heart. And so long as we're blaming the woman for the lust in the man, we're not teaching modesty. We're just blame shifting. Now, that having been said, we shouldn't therefore conclude, well, good, I can just dress wherever the heck I want. If a guy has a bad imagination, then that's his own problem. It's like, well, no, we need to feel responsible for each other. And so we can build a civilization of love. And so what modesty does is it helps a guy to fall in love for all the right reasons, to realize there's so much more about you than just your body. But I think we definitely need to be promoting modesty very clearly to the guys as well as the girls, because I've had so many guys and their moms tell me, like, I used to think it was the boys going after the girls, but you should see the messages that my son is getting on his phone from some of those girls at a quote unquote Catholic high school. I can't believe what these girls are wanting the boys to do. And so now more than ever, it is going in both directions, but I really try to push the guys in particular that it's not her job to be your chastity cop. It's not her job to tell you when to stop. It's not her job to tell you, I'm comfortable doing this, but not that. It's your job as a guy never to put her in a situation where she'd ever have to say no in the first place. It's not her job to be your conscience, okay? There's times she's going to be tempted and you should be strong. Instead of whenever she's tempted, then you think, well, that's as far as I can go. That's imbalanced. So I think girls as well as guys deserve a full message of chastity, because it's something that affects and impacts all of us.
Does that make sense to you, Teresa?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, I completely agree. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's go to Tina in South Dakota. Tina, thank you for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Jason Evert.
Hi. I am right now, unfortunately, I get very emotional, going through a divorce. We're Catholic, my husband and I, and we've had our ups and downs in our marriage. But in the last 3 years, I just felt like, you know, I knew he had watched porn, and he had convinced me that it was okay to watch it. And I'm a very modest person, and I'm very shy when it comes to that type of stuff, and I just didn't feel comfortable with it, and so I stopped, and I told him, I just said, look, I can't be those people on TV. That's not reality. And so I feel like he got bored with me, with intimacy or whatnot. We didn't even really have any intimacy because he was thinking of other things, and I was trying to get him to think of me so we could connect. And it's just been really tough on me. I'm shocked that he has been seeing a woman for 3 years. It's devastated me, and I don't quite know how to deal with it, but I feel like he might be more attracted to her because she's easier to manipulate when it comes to sex, things like that. But I took a vow, and I took my vow very serious. I don't believe in divorce, but I don't know what else to do. If I should stop it and say I'm not going to sign any papers, or what is your suggestion?
Yeah. Well, first and foremost, I want to ask every single person who is listening to Catholic Answers Live right now to just start storming heaven for you, for him, to just start offering up prayers for your consolation, for your strength, because you've been suffering so much, because you're not asking for too much in this relationship. A lot of guys who are addicted to porn will gaslight women into think, wow, you're being too picky. I'm not actually doing it. What's the big problem? Dude, you're not asking for anything other than what's standard in a relationship of just fidelity. That's it. It's like you're buying a car. You're not asking for a sunroof. You're just asking for tires. And the salesman is like, wow, that's a lot to ask for, don't you think? It's like, no, this should come part and parcel with the package. And so, you know, in terms of the approach to take with divorce, talk to your spiritual director, a good priest at your parish, because he might be able to look at this thing and say, okay, did your husband validly enter into a sacramental marriage? Like, did you have full knowledge of where this guy was at? Because in order to enter this valid marriage, you have to fulfill the essential obligations of marriage. Was he? This is something to ask the pastor about. And I hear the music coming, because and maybe you can stay online and we can chat for a few minutes afterwards.
Hang on, Tina.
First quick thing I'd say, talk to the priest, and then we'll talk in a few minutes off the air.
And that will do it for us. We'll see you Monday, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.